was based on a paper I had with Bert working, okay, and I just gave this title. But what I really want to talk about is the space of non-extremal vacuums. So a lot has been understood about the space of multicentered Suzy solutions, and we've been hearing about it for the last 3 days now. And we have understood entropy enigma, we have wall crossings, fuzz balls, and some other things which I don't completely understand, but people have understood a lot about a multicentered supersymmetric, and even now we have non-Suzy but extremal solutions. We know quite a bit about them. But the information paradox doesn't exist for extremal black holes because they don't emit. So JMART is a non-extremal solution, non-extremal smooth solution, but it's notoriously hard to generalize. And many people have tried, and Amitabh is trying to generalize it now, and he knows it's very hard. So according to what Yosef said, I mean, this Romanian saying that don't pray to the saints who don't listen, so we try something else. So recently there has been some activity in using non-perturbative probes around black holes / fuzzballs to study non-extremal system.
But for those of us who don't follow the supermarket, what is JMART?
JMART is this non-extremal fuzzball which was made by a group in Durham, and it had a classical instability which Mathur and I identified with the Hawking radiation of these fuzzballs. So but they're classically unstable, but there are some fuzzballs which are non-extremal emit. So there's this one class of solutions which are completely smooth, no horizon, and they have a classical emission. But anyway, I'm not going to talk about fuzzballs or smooth solutions in this talk, so it's not really relevant. So this talk is about my approach to this problem of what to do with non-extremal black holes. And I'll report on this recent results in the analogs of entropy enigma / super radiance for non-extremal 5D black holes with super tube probes. And I'll try to finish in time, and I'll try to finish with reporting on some of the current work I'm doing on this subject. So let's see. So emission for black holes happen in two ways. There's Hawking radiation, where the black holes evaporate away, increasing the total entropy of the system, but decreasing their own. The area of the black hole shrinks in the process. While in super radiance, the black holes expel angular momentum or charge, increasing their own entropy in the process. The horizon area increases during super radiance. And presumably the endpoint is a condensate outside the black hole. And in some cases, this has been constructed. So the endpoint is hairy black holes, where the hair is basically charge or angular momentum leaking out of the black hole. And you have Einstein-Maxwell theory has charge condensate. You have various 5 black holes with R charge here. You have enigmatic black holes in 4D n equal to 2, which is also an example, although in an extremal case. So it's not really an emission in a dynamical sense, but it's thermodynamically favorable. And what we want to do is look for similar phenomena, that is horizon entropy increased by emission in the D1 defect system, because that's more under control. So let's see, what is the D1 defect system? So for this D1 defect system, we consider type 2B on S1 cross M4, where M4 could be T4 or K3. We wrap N1 D1 brains on S1. We wrap N5 D5 brains on S1 and M4, and NP units of momentum along S1. And this system has some angular momentum in the transverse SO4. We take S1 to be much larger than M4. What this does is, first of all, it produces ADS3 cross S3. You can see that from the geometry. But more importantly, what happens is, by doing this, we make D5s and D1s heavy, because they're wrapping the S1. But momentum is light. So now if you start with an extremal system, a supersymmetric system, you dump in some energy, central charge is given by N1 and N5. You don't want that to change. You want the same theory, but you want excitations on that theory. You take this limit, then any extra energy, even though it's equipartitioned, but these are just too heavy, so it just produces momentum and anti-momentum, excitations on this. Oops. The Higgs branch of this system flows in the infrared to a 1+1 dimensional N equal to 4, 4 superconformal field theory with the target space, which is the resolution of the symmetric product orbifold. Now, there's a lot of evidence for the so-called orbifold point where the target space is this thing. It's not the resolution. It's just this symmetric product orbifold. And that is where most of the CFT analysis of the D1 defect system is done. So the orbifold point of the system looks something like this. I just said the target space of the 1+1 dimensional CFT is a symmetric product orbifold. This orbifolding produces twist sectors. So if you have this N is N1 times N5. So you have N1, N5 windings, N1, N5 copies, But the orbit coding produces twist sectors. So you can have, this is, for example, a sigma 3, where you go around the first copy. This is one copy, two copy, three copy, but if you go around first, you end up on the second, then on the third, and then back. So that's the sigma 3. You can have up to sigma n, where it's the maximum twisted sector. The symmetry group of this of S3, which is a support, is the R charge, and you can write it as SU2 left or SU2 right. Excitations on this CFT correspond to left movers and right movers. They are they have some momentum. They correspond to momentum in the d1, d5, p, and they are possible R charge. So if they are fermions, they carry some R charge. They correspond to rotation of the system. Twists by themselves in the Ramon sector have R charge. So this is like the R charge or the SU2 left, SU2 right charge of every. These are called component strings. Each of these twists. So this is a ground state. Because there are different spins, but there's no excitation. This is a supersymmetric state with only left excitations. This is a supersymmetric state with only right excitations. And this is a non-supersymmetric state because it has left and right excitations. So this is enough of d1, d5, CFT for this talk. Are there any questions on this? This is essential for understanding the rest. So now, in the Cardi formula, things are pretty, it's universal. So if you are in this range where this NP is much bigger than N roughly, if you include the JL here, then the Cardi formula works and this is the entropy. This is also the entropy of the BMPV black hole. At the orbit four point, you can reproduce this formula by putting all the excitations on one long string. You take all the N1, N5 copies of it, you make one long twisted string out of it, you put all the excitations on this thing and you'll recover this entropy. However, try this sample size outside the Cardi region. We take L units of winding out of the system and make a short string condensate, L of them. What this does is it takes away from N, so it's going to reduce the entropy, but it also takes away from J left, because these component strings are charged under the R charge, so it's taking away from both of them. So obviously there's competition between this term and this term, and here are the charges of these things. You don't really have to read them and just wrote them down for completeness. These are the winding momentum, R charge and entropy. And you extremize this entropy formula with respect to L. So how much you take out. You do this and you get this phase diagram. So let me explain what the phase diagram is. This blue line is actually not a line, it's this parabola. And the BMPV black hole only exists above this. This is called the cosmic censorship bound because the single-centered black hole ceases to exist outside of this. The lower was that nothing exists below this. I mean, between this blue line and this is called the unitarity bound, which is imposed by the CFT, the kind of states you can have. The lower was there's nothing here, no black objects here, because of a result by Nagur, where he showed that the elliptic genus of CFT and Sugra match in this gray shaded region. These corners were left out, but it was believed that it would work there. It's just harder to calculate. But in this gray region, the proof was there. So the elliptic genus was matching, and the lower is anything that can lift will lift. So the idea was, since it's matching the Sugra elliptic genus, there are no black objects here. But at least at the orbit four point, we find something with black hole-ish entropy in this region. Anyway, this thing is not protected by the elliptic genus. These are not counted by the elliptic genus. So there's no guarantee that when we move in the moduli space, these guys will not lift, because these could be, I mean, these are like for every short multiplet, every state, bosonic state, there's a fermionic state. If you change the moduli, they could combine, form a long multiplet, they could lift. So let's see if we can construct them on the gravity side. So you do this by looking at multi-center solutions, which we have heard a lot about, so I'm not going to explain anything about it, but we work in the SU truncation. So what we do is one center is a black hole. It's in the entropy frame, it's M2 brain, wrapping these directions. So the first M2 wraps 5 and 6. And it's smeared along 7, 8, 9, 10, and the second one wraps these directions, and so on. And then the other center is a supertube, which is M2 brains wrapping these guys, and an M5 brain enclosing these M2 brains, and extending along one extra direction in the non-compact space in 5D. So that's the supertube in this incarnation. And I'll talk about more about supertubes, obviously, but I'm just going through some old results. By old, I mean from September last year. So then we maximize the entropy of this configuration by shuffling around charges between these two centers. The reason it's a two-center solution is that there's only one SU2R multiplet. So if there's one angular momentum multiplet, it can come from only two centers. here more senses and there's more one. So we maximize the entropy by shuffling the charges between these two. And this is the phase diagram. And what we find on the Subra side is this diagram. So I'll explain what's going on. Again, this dotted line here, the blue dotted line, is the cosmic censorship bound. The BMPV exists above this. The new phase on the safety side, the orbital point, existed in this entire triangle and was dominant over the BMPV, over the long string sector. However, on the gravity side, it exists in this entire triangle, but it dominates over the black hole only in this tiny, this is a blow up of this region, only in a tiny region. However, it continues to exist beyond the cosmic censorship bound all the way to the unitarity bound. In this region, it looks like a BMPV plus supertube. And in this region, the dominant phase is BMPV plus supertube. And in this region, the dominant phase is a black line. So this was the result we had in the paper. One of the missing. No, I'll show. Yeah, so the screen didn't. STU. Yeah, I'll come to that. Yeah, that's important. This is in n equal to 2. So I'll come to that in the end of the talk. So in the Suzy case, we had only left moves, and this is what we had done. This is long string. We took out some short string condensate. But this gave me the idea that I could do this at the orbifold point, at least, for non-supersymmetric, non-extremal states also. And for the simplest case, you just take the same charges for left and right. So L0 equal to L0 bar, S2 to left, S2 right, and you have this thing. And you don't even have to do a calculation again. It's the same answer. It's twice the entropy. And this is going to be dominant. This is going to be dominant over this guy. So this is there. We would expect to see non-extremal molting. However, how do you see that? There is no well-developed technique for non-extremal multicenter solutions. So we can't do that. But we can always work in the probe limit. So we look at the DBI Bezdomian action of the supertube in a Swethicium background. I'll explain what a Swethicium is, but it's a non-extremal black hole in 5D. So, this is a five-dimensional non-extremal black hole. It's charged as the three U1s, so that basically the M2, 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 and it has two independent rotations, two rotations in independent planes. It can be embedded in M-theory this way. So you have M2 brains and anti-M2 brains. Because it's non-extremal, you give energy, it's going to excite all the charges, unless you tune the size of the torus in some way. So it has M2s and anti-M2s of each T2. If you reduce this on direction 5, you get F1, D2, D2 system. It's important for the supertube analysis. But if you then do these dualities on this system, you get D5, D1, D. So it's the D1, D5 system in this incarnation. So this is just to show that it can be related to D1, D5 system. So, but I'll study the system in this way. So this is the metric. You put the probe decode, we are going to put the probe decode rate on this metric after reduction on direction 5. But this is the M-theory metric. What you probably want to focus on is this base metric. It doesn't look like R4, and it has this non-extremal parameter M in it, and that's why you can't construct multicenter solutions that easily. This is the metric, and we're going to look at that probe action on this. So the background I've already explained. We have it in this incarnation by reducing this thing. The probe supertube is the same, but it's going to be supersymmetric in the sense that it only has M2s and not anti-M2s. It's two of the M2s wrap in this direction. So this one is common with that one, this one, but the third M2 is missing. And there's also an M5 paragon. When you dimension reduce it, you get F1, D2 dissolved inside a D4. The D4 is this brain. Because the M5 was making a contractible loop in the non-compact direction, the D4 also does that. That's the alpha direction. So we look at the action of this D4. It's given the DBA is the resume of D. The DBA is the resume of D. There's a Einstein error which some of the paper. You reduce it to this way, and then the F1 charge comes from this expression. The action, the derivative action with respect to F06, the y1 plus. And the D2 charge is given by this flux.
maybe it's the artifact, I mean, it must be artifact moving the modular space. Obviously, these are not the same theories, but marginally formed from each other. And here, if it was orthogonal, I did not see anything. And here, on the, this is the safety side. On the both sides, we found better stable states. So, till now we have kept V1 equal to 1, V2 equal to 0. This means the
they don't, they're not details in the SQL.
No, they're the action of the SQL.
No, there's a lot of action. Some of them are not the control. I didn't use
the
control. You can't control. You can't control. If you don't write them to the normal spread system, it just becomes symmetric. Because you have to digitalize twice to go to the normal. So this is, those are bits on the T4 and the DR5 frame. So if you digitalize on the T4 twice, let's say, to go to the DT, which then you take the SQ, they just become more diagonal.
Well, you can call what you want. The SQ model has three scalars, and those scalars have pseudo-scalar part. These are complex scalars. If you turn those on, I believe you move away from that single surface.
So it's really one of the four devices. Okay. I looked at it briefly. I thought it was not the case, but I can look again and discuss. But when you turn on the market. So this kind of goes in direction of what you're saying. So kind of, I mean, unless there's some other definition of supersymmetric cubes, you can make sure kind of more what charges, I don't know. But it goes in that direction. So the attractive force lives in local minima even in the supersymmetries. So can we use that in the directions? So what we've done is we have made some progress towards understanding the phase space of near zero black holes. We found, as expected from the CFT evidence that I've already put a point, there are stable multicenter solutions. We found a generalized notion of algorithms, which is kind of cute, that I agree with you, but it's so cute, that we think that algorithm is a property of black holes, but it's not. It's a property of black holes, it's a property of probe. We take a different probe, it's a different algorithm. It might not be seen, it might seem to exist, I don't know, there might be more than a probe. Now, the other thing is that this part was what we've done and this is what we can do. So we have singular safety, we know this orbital point is related to this right now. These guys, if you're on the second rule being a street, we got stable state becoming marginal and then unstable. Now the question is that we were motivated by a CFT calculation at the orbital point. What if you turn on the central BNSC at the orbital point? Can we see that this effect that is stable becoming marginal and unstable? So there is a technique for this. I mean, the guys, the operators in the CFT, which are known to these BNSCs, are known. There are particular kinds of sigma 2 twist off, where they take two strands of the at the orbital point and twist them together and make one, or they can take one and break it. That we see that with every master diet, develop some formalism from to move away from the orbital point. So it's still messy, and you still need to put it in a computer, but the formalism is there, and while we code it, and then what we see, there's no, I couldn't find a problem to use this, but the formalism is there, and we say, so one could look at these motive states at orbital point for extremal and non-extremal, and see what happens to the CFT version of the input anymore. And now the same procedure can be repeated on fully calculating voting black holes. You take the full solution that we have in our paper, in the extreme model. You dualize the DQDC frame, the DQDP, rotate, dualize back, turn on the correct amount of nearest fields at infinity so there are no source DQ frames, we turn on another. But to do this, I don't know what we see. We might do a full feeling spin analysis to see whether it's broken to zero or not. I don't know, this is something we want to do. And the same procedure can be repeated on these solutions. We have this fuzzball solution, multi-center fuzzball solution, and the supertube is metastable non-trivial. Now this is already more than two centers. What Samir is going to say is that we have two centers, half deepest centers. They will remain supersymmetric when you turn on multiply. But there are two centers at least, and the supertube, probe supertube is the third center. So they already follow to that criteria. So you'd expect that these guys would become. So yeah, the same procedure can be repeated on this. And I think that's it. Yeah.
Some guy which has some charges,
yeah.
That's going to be supersymmetric by construction. What's wrong with that? I mean, because I started from a supersymmetric solution, I do a bunch of dualities, so I mean, it should be supersymmetric.
No, the rotation is rotating on a compact torus, so that can break supersymmetry.
That's very hard.
I mean, in classical, like you see what you're saying, you just rotate it completely, but.
No, from the point of view of the, from the point of view of Fortis for gravity, it's just some foundation in the space of solutions. I mean, something which should not be the subject should be there and should be alive in place. There's no reason why, the supertube doesn't become something else. I mean, nobody said, well, you didn't have any, the Bible doesn't say that supertubes are the supersymmetric guys away from the multiply. I mean, there's no, it could be someone else.
It could be. In this problem, I was really thinking that, well, the problem is you want to take the DMDPI system and say something split out for it. And the thing that came out should just be DMDPI. You can, what should I turn on?
No, but the motion I turn on, for example,
at the detail level, I don't know what to turn on.
When you have people turn on, for example, the stuff which splits out can have some of the charges in the detail. So there's no reason why something pops out, for example, because you have charges in the
process. There's another thing. What we did, I've not checked this because I just asked my colleague to do this morning, but what he's saying is that a lot of BPU. So basically, it's an angle, right? I mean, you're rotating. So you turn on close to pi by 2, that's what I do. Pi by 2. And then what you see is that you can turn on these other charges in supercharge because it's like F1 in this direction, F1 in that direction, there's another F1, and there's all these B2. And you tried a couple of them, and no matter how large you made them, a state which is not bound did not get bound again. But again, this is a scanning problem. I just did this, and he did this morning, so I don't want to comment too much on it. But
no,
it seems like.
Just take one of those just a normal supercube, which is supersymmetric, and you know, whatever you do, like this, it's still supersymmetric. It's all right.